Siren Tales Spring Season. My name is Nimsh, and I'm here on the couch with Raven, as usual, and with Gara, a new addition to the casting couch. Welcome back, man. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you doing?
I'm doing great as well. Having a lot of fun here at DreamHack. Well, it's not a DreamHack. It's actually a PGL event, but Romania Bucharest. And like watching Gara in Romania always reminds me of this first DreamHack that you won, man.
Yeah. It feels really bad to like drop out in group stages in Romania, especially. It's like kind of my hometown, sort of. I was doing so well in the past, so I'm kind of sad, but I'm happy at the same time because it's such a great event, man. This studio is amazing. There's very few studios, you should know yourself, that are like this epic. Like
absolutely.
This
the production quality as well, like with the different shots we have and the replays. It feels like World Championships, actually, in a sense, like production-wise.
Yeah, it's really awesome. And as we sort of mentioned before, it's really cool to have like the players just they're literally just sat over there, and you're all talking and watching the games as well, so we get to see their reactions. And yeah, it's just good overall. And Gara, even though you did get knocked out, you get to cast with us. So,
yeah,
you know,
it's
there's
fun.
Always a bonus.
It's been a while since my last cast, actually, so hype.
All right, and the next match we're going to see Janet Druid from Poland versus Scruffy. Do you remember from where Scruffy is?
Off the top of my head, no. Okay. You've just dropped me in it, Nimsh.
Oh, sorry. This is surprise there.
He's from Czech Republic.
Okay.
He's Pavel from Czech Republic. There's like three Pavels from Czech Republic.
It's actually interesting because Czech Republic and Poland are neighboring countries, and there is some communication between countries overall, and a lot of players in Czech Republic as well as a lot of players in Poland. I think Czech Republic overall is a bit more competitive. Like they have very big teams like Asuba,
yeah,
and they have a big history in card games overall. Like a lot of people playing Magic, Yu-Gi-Oh, Pokemon as well. And in Poland, Poland tries to mirror that as well. Like we have a lot of players playing Magic, and Hearthstone community is growing bigger and bigger. So it's interesting that we have this clash of the neighboring countries, and even though friendly countries mostly.
Yeah, and even like these are two of the guys. So, you know, we saw earlier today with Tyze versus Powder, like, you know, sort of a clashing of some very big names in the Hearthstone scene. And these are two guys that are maybe, well, a lot less known. I know Scruffy said, I believe in his interview, that he, you know, this is his first big tournament ever. So he's got to be, and he seems just like super excited to just be here, actually, and just play and get this far. So this is going to be a big opportunity for him to actually, you know, make a really, really big impact in his first tournament.
And I actually lost to him in the group stages against Scruffy. So
you're going to be biased.
Yeah.
Yeah, he did prove himself not only winning versus you in the group stages, but also he won versus Crane yesterday. Close match, but still winning versus player like Crane, who was supposed to be, well, who is one of the best or most known players in this tournament overall, dropping out early. You know, Scruffy is still in, and he is guaranteed $1,000 at least and 2 HTT points, and he's fighting to double it, to get 2,500 at least.
Yeah, and we were talking as well earlier about even the increase to like 5 points is actually a good number, even though the season's is over 3 months. Like 5 points is like a huge impact for a tournament over one weekend, because then you can continue to ladder and play in some of the other online cups to gain more points and really build those up.
Absolutely.
I would also say that he's like one of the favorites to win it all from now on, for sure.
And then on the other hand, we have Janet Druid from Poland, playing for No Mercy. Janet is mostly known for qualifying for Seed Story Cup 3. The one you've mentioned was one of the best tournaments, Gara, that you participated in.
Also, I've seen Janet Druid so many times because I've been playing like online cups from the beginning, and you always see those names like Janet Druid and others. And that it's no surprise that he came so far in this tournament. As well.
Absolutely, absolutely. All right, we actually sat down with those players. Let's hear what they have to say about themselves.
Right now I feel really great. I think I made maybe like small misplays, but overall I think it was really good series, and it's amazing that I won.
So I knew from yesterday that I'm gonna play Crane, so I tried to prepare a little bit more than for yesterday's, because I knew his lineup from the top 30, not top 32, from the Swiss stage. But yeah, he had an option to change his lineup, so it wasn't really like I know he's gonna play the Freeze Mage again.
If I make it to the final, I think I would like to face Tyze. He's, I think, the strongest player here. He's right now 6-0 in his matches, so he's really, really strong right now.
Like, I enjoyed this event so much up to this point, and I think tomorrow will be like the best day of this this tournament. And yeah, I'm enjoying like everything, like the atmosphere, like every player is like so friendly, and I don't know a lot of them. Like I know some like four or three guys there, or I knew before this event. And like, yeah, everyone is so friendly and you guys are awesome.
I think European scene is really, really strong. There is a lot of players from different countries. Oh, it's really nice opportunity to meet them all and like share some thoughts on current meta or Hearthstone overall.
They are such lovable guys. It's just you know, one and the and the second one also like enjoying the tournament, having fun, and just trying to meet new people and make friends. But I think like winning the tournament, not even winning this round, but winning the tournament will be life changing for them. They will get enough money to be able to travel to more events, maybe go to DreamHack Summer in the future, and also those points to qualify for the spring prelims, and maybe play in the European Championships in spring and go to BlizzCon in the end.
Yeah, it's a really big deal for these guys, and you know, you touched on a good point there, where actually, you know, a lot of the sort of like lesser known players don't have teams that can really fund a lot of trips, and getting this prize money and actually spending it on going to more events like, you know, DreamHack Summer, some of the big ones, is going to be really huge for these guys and just build on something they're already working on here.
I like how he said, like, everyone is so friendly. He said it like five times. Everyone is so friendly.
He loves
couldn't
it.
Believe it.
And even the shout out to the PGL guys, like, even you guys are cool. So, you know, super nice guy.
Yeah, well, big shout out to PGL guys, because actually everybody is really friendly. And the teams, the cameraman.
They're all smiling.
Yeah. Everybody's smiling. Smiling.
We have them on the other side of the screen, just like.
We're not under the gun.
No, yeah, there's no, like, you know, evil looking eyes, like, pressure.
Absolutely. All right. Classes. We have Druid, Shaman, Warrior for Janna Druid, and Druid, Warlock, and Warrior for Scruffy. Gara, what can you tell me about this decks?
Scruffy changed his lineup. That's like the first thing. He played Freeze Mage in the group stages, which like really caught me off guard, to be honest, because it doesn't make so much sense to bring Freeze Mage in a no-ban format. You rather expect Tempo Mage, especially because he played Zoo as well. And I think he also played Patron Warrior, so it really fit in his lineup to also play Tempo Mage, but now he mixed it up again. Could be even Control Warrior, who knows. No Freeze Mage there. Janna Druid was the only Shaman player, you said, right?
There's one more. Tracky Style also has a Shaman deck.
Yep.
So it's probably an Aggro Shaman. I wouldn't expect him to change it to a Control Shaman.
Surprise.
You'd love it though, wouldn't you?
You're a Garfest Shaman.
Of all people, you would appreciate this.
I want to see at least one player like, wow. When was the last time you see like any Control Shaman?
Pimping Co at BlizzCon.
That was the last time.
Probably, yeah. I haven't.
Like overall, also like in group stages or anywhere, it's like the last time we saw.
Yeah, I think Pimping Co played in other tournaments and he was bringing Shaman as well, but the mid-range.
Yeah, mid-range version. Yeah.
Aggro Shaman is pretty good. I like it. I like the deck. Unfortunately for Raven, it killed Hunter, but the deck is really viable, and as we can see, it's not that easy to play as well. Sometimes if you miss the mulligan, if you don't know how to mulligan specifically in the matchups, or if you trade when you should go for phase, or if you go for phase where you could have actually traded, you just lose the game. The difference between winning and losing is really thin.
Yeah, and I think having a really good knowledge of the potential of your deck as well and how much reach you've got, because there are some times when you have to just soak the damage, take it to face, because you know you're going to, you know, the chance of you drawing into something like a Lava Burst or a Crackle are really high. But just like we are going to start with the Warrior versus Druid matchup, and so far, this looks like Patron Warrior, be it mainly because of the unstable ghoul that we can see, and the Druid looks like a Druid, so there's nothing too crazy going on at the moment.
Yeah, this matchup is, we've seen it many times before because of Patron and Druid being really popular. And I want to hear Gara's opinion on it. Like, what do you think? Who is favored and why?
Statistically, the Druid is favored like 56% or something.
Really?
Yeah.
And mentally, it seems like Patron is favored because it has the tools.
Yeah, everyone who plays Patron says, oh, it's such a good deck against Druid, even though it's like not favored. But it's like with Rogue, right? The Rogue players who play Rogue, they say, yeah, it's favorite against Druid, and who plays Druid says, yeah, it's favorite against Rogue. But I think Patron is obviously still much more difficult to play. Like, just about the mulligan decision. Like, as a Druid, you're like, okay, I'm mulligan for Wildgrowth Innovate, and if I have it, I keep like a Shredder. But Patron, like, you can think about every single card to keep. You can think about keeping Unstable Ghouls, Acolytes, Weapons. inner rage. Like I've seen people like who are really good who always keep inner rage, and it just makes sense. Like it's like a core card in every matchup. It's so many different ways to mulligan, like slams, like execute even. You could keep against Druid execute. Makes sense. If he gets like a turn 3 Dr. Boom or something and you execute that, suddenly you're a favorite in the matchup.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think a lot of players that when they're playing Patron, they actually hold off on the mulligan as long as possible to see what the Druid mulliganed. And if the Druid like kept like 3 cards, you normally keep hold of an execute if you have the option. Because as you said, you know, there are chances of crazy innovate plays. I also think having the Death Bite in hand now already for Jaina Druid, that it is really powerful because, you know, it deals with so many of the bigger minions from the Druid and can really help enable the patrons that he's drawn, for example.
Absolutely. With that patron, he actually will have options on the patron turn, but he's still looking for inner rage or maybe a world in the fact. Gar, do you think like right now in his hand, is it enough with unstable goal?
I think he's like heavily favored in this specific match. A Druid needs to cheat to get like a hatch in those matches. Like you need the Viagraphs, you need the inner raids, you need to apply the early pressure so you can finish with the combo. Like right now, he's like behind in damage, not just like... Yes, he's not behind on board or anything, he can clear stuff, but the damage is really missing. Like, getting like a Shredder out on turn 2, like those hits, like sometimes you deal 12 damage against the Warrior with the Shredder because he War Axes it twice or something, and it's so important to do that damage so you have enough pressure to finish him off with the combo. Being behind in damage is like a big deal. So
absolutely. But then on the other hand, the Druid has some tools to deal with the first patron outburst. Wrath is really nice to kill one patron, and it's only for 2 mana. If he is able to play that... Pilot the Shredder on the next turn, he will have some minions. Shade is going to grow overall and outgrow the possible double whirlwind. So if there are 4 patrons on turn 5, he should be good.
You could say like the difference between really good Druid players and like the very top, like Thais, for example, he would never use a Wrath like in this matchup, except for the patrons to clear them. A lot of people just like use them here to cycle or whatever, draw like some bigger mid-range creatures or combo, but Thais, for example, would never like use Wrath or Swipe before like Azure Drake for something.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and this is going to be really interesting now, whether he chooses to Death Bite into the Shredder or not, because the issue is he kind of wants to try and guard this Ghoul or at least make him reveal the Shade to clear it off, because once Death Bite's equipped, you know, you go into turn 5, it's just another Whirlwind effect that can proc a patron, so... Yeah, we might have to see this game, at least the early stage of it, sort of decided by what comes out of the Shredder.
Yeah, actually, if there's something with one health that Unstable Ghoul can kill and stay on board for one more turn, that would be pretty good for Jaina.
He's also missing like combo cards with Patron. He has the Death Bite plus Patron, but he has like no Inner Rage, no Whirlwind, so you need like 4 patrons at least if you want to go for the patrons. So it makes sense to use your War Axes first. Like his hand is like clocked with a lot of weapons.
Yeah, but he doesn't have necessarily, he doesn't have to go into Patron on turn 5. I think he can wait, just keep his Death Bite online with one durability point, and next turn maybe slam and execute something. Well, that's pretty good for Jaina Druid here. Because his Ghoul is not contested, you probably want to still keep your Shade hidden next this turn.
Yeah, do you think there's a chance, because this is just such a big setup for a Patron turn, although... It's a real tough one. He could Wrath just to clear off the Ghoul and be really safe, but to be fair, the Ghoul can't kill itself next turn either, currently on this board. So, you know, there's a chance that he could just ignore it, but then you're pretty much passing your turn, which never feels good.
Can you just, like, slam Keeper and silence it? To deny the Whirlwind effect? If there is Acolyte of Pain maybe next turn?
Yeah, it's a tough one. I think this is just a safer option, especially because he already has a Wrath in hand, so you know, like you were saying, Gar, it's good to just use Wrath for patrons solely. But I think because he has a Wrath, he has a Keeper of the Grove as well, so he can kill off the 3-2 patron if he really needs to. Like, he does have answers, whereas leaving the Ghoul up could have caused him actually a lot more problems.
You cannot leave the Ghoul up because he has also the Death Bite equipped.
Exactly, yeah.
But this hand is. Oh, suddenly the hand kind of sucks.
Is this actually a battle rage for one here?
Is it just a cycle? Possibly.
Yeah, you cannot go for patrons, it's bad. Yeah, this is also like very... I like those situations because like the very... To see like the best patron players, what would they do in this situation, you know? There's I've seen people just using like hero power pass in such situations. Some people just use battle rage for one, as you said. Okay. It's like some people would probably slam even, you know, just to draw cards. Like, what is like what has more value at this point.
Yeah, what is the difference between a slam and Battle Rage?
Yeah. Like it's but you need the slam for the execute.
Yeah, I was going to say the execute in hand is probably the main difference there, but I completely agree actually, Gar. I think it's really, it's very easy to look at a perfect curve and be like, oh yeah, the guy's good. Yeah. But like to look at how these guys play when they don't have the, you know, like the easy options every turn is really interesting.
This
to
is
why
I enjoy like Life Coach when he plays Druid, when he has like a really bad hand. Sometimes he manages to win games, like even against Zoo with Druid, and he had like no Wycroft, no Innovate. He's thinking so much, and he still somehow kind of manages to win the game. This is where you really see like the difference. Yeah, when someone has like a sick curve, you know.
Yeah, fine.
Yeah, easy game.
So the Emperor's going to come down, and this is kind of okay because it almost forces the Death Spite, or at least if not Death Spite, an execute. Because it's not a card you can really leave up in any matchup, to be honest. And look at the value he's getting on the hand as well. He does have the Innovate, which obviously isn't going to be affected by Emperor, but he has a lot of cards to follow up with. So he's got the Dr. Boom, he has the Ancient of Lore to continue to draw if he wants to. And that Shade is still sitting pretty safe, and there's actually no real way for the Warrior to deal with the Shade now. So there is an option where the Druid could actually just wait.
Yeah.
Use the Ancient of Lore to build up and then just burst him down with a big combo in the Shade later.
But this is the perfect term for patrons anyway. Like, you try to get those patrons as much as possible, getting the Battle Rage as well to fill your hand. Even though Druid can deal with that, as a patron player, you hope he can't. It's a pretty good turn for Janet Druid, just contesting the board with those patrons, asking his opponent, can you deal with this? And then he still has a follow-up with Dr. Boom.
He would die to combo, but this is where the risks you have to take. Like, after Emperor, you're always like, okay, if you have it, you have it.
Yeah. So he can... Can he clear now?
Yeah, easily.
Yeah, he can clear. So he has Wrath, Keeper of the Grove, Living Roots, and then the Shade, I guess.
Yeah, attack with Shade can he can attack with Shade definitely, but does he have to really attack with Shade? Keeper the free.
You're using Hero Power instead, right?
He could also just silence if he doesn't want to D-Shade.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, Hero Power, silence, and then Living Roots the 3/2.
But then why would you not if you clear everything anyway? So like attack with the Shade into the 3/3, kill the 3/2.
It's just playing around execute, right? Like, because it's built up so much now.
But the execute should be fine because you have Dr. Boom next turn and Nation of Lore.
That's true.
Yeah, it really depends on the hand. Like, his hand is, like, pure value right now. Like, if you're holding combo, then you really don't want to de-shield, stealth, because you want to finish the game. But here, you can outvalue your opponent. This is, like, where Druid transitions from, like, a combo tempo deck into, like, a value control deck.
So he did it a bit differently, but the outcome was the same. He revealed the Shade and killed all the patrons. He doesn't have the Keeper on board in the end, and he took some damage instead, but it should still be fine.
Yeah, this Lightwell's still up doing some work, so this has actually been healing, like, you know, bits and bobs across every turn, which is pretty funny. We saw this, I think, yesterday, a Lightwell, and it was just up forever. Just because it's not a priority kill target, but then you realize the healing it's doing actually makes it super valuable.
Yeah, it's so funny that it actually was good for Janet Druid in the beginning when it showed up, that it wasn't contesting the goal, but in the end, it's actually annoying.
Would have loved to slam the Dr. Boom there. Always one mana off.
He's actually at 17. That's not a good total. 16 now.
Yeah, and this is one of those weird situations that when you're playing against Druid, like, we can see there's no combo pieces in hand, but you cannot presume there are. You know, you kind of have to clear, especially with a Boom now, and even that Lightwell still providing the extra damage. Like, it's a pretty rough situation.
Well, there is a Whirlwind now as well, so he can go for Patron and hope that some bombs actually hit the Patron. He can still execute Dr. Boom afterwards.
Yeah, this is also like one of those gamble situations, but you have to take the risk.
Yeah, also if there is a combo, it's just dead if the bombs hit face. But what can you do?
Would you ever go for Patron, say?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, like, is there anything better? Like, do you set up Armorsmith and try to protect yourself in a way?
I don't think that he needs, like, he's like, when he uses the Patron here and the Druid is able to clear it, he doesn't have Patriots anymore, right? But he has the Dr. Boom already and the Grommash. He probably doesn't need like too many patrons.
Yeah.
So it's probably fine to go for it.
And if Druid plays minions, you will be able to play Armorsmith and just trade your minions into minions and gain health and escape the range of the combo.
Yep, so where are these bombs going to go? Oh, okay. Non-hit patron, so, you know, sort of good but sort of bad. You kind of normally want the low hits on the patrons and not the big hits to kill off them.
Well, Janet thinks he's dead, but he will know he's not yet, at least. And there are actually tools to deal with those patrons here. And even play Piloted Shredder afterwards.
You want a Hero Power though, right?
Right.
Yeah, Hero Power to clear up the board. Because this still represents a huge threat. The Druid's nowhere near lethal in terms of his own health, I mean. Yeah. Whereas this is so much pressure still on the Warrior. And now even like the Armorsmith doesn't look too great. It's probably going to come down along with Dr. Boom, maybe. Because he's dead to combo either way, whether he Hero Powers or not. But yeah, this feels kind of awkward.
Well, it's such a bad feeling to play against Druid when you're so low on life. Every turn you're expecting to die.
You could have just stopped that sentence a bit early. It's such a bad feeling to play against Druid.
Yeah.
Full stop.
What about Slam? Was Slam weapon attack valuable there? Because you play around Savage Roar a bit? If there's like double Savage Roar or even a single Savage Roar with something in hand?
Yeah, it's a tough one. I think the armor up just is okay. Because again, like you sort of, I think you get in the mindset of the full combo, right? So if you're dead to it anyway, like it should be okay there.
And I don't know if he runs Sludge Belt, so he maybe wants to draw off the slam to get a taunt.
I think I'll probably slam it, because if you don't slam it, you're dead to Druid of the Claw Savage Roar, I believe. And then if without slamming it, you're not dead to that combination at least.
I wonder what's going through Johnny Druid's mind at the moment, because he's just like, really? Still no combo? Like, what's going on? Why are you just playing minions, Druid? What are you doing?
Well, apparently his opponent is not as Janet as Janet Druid, which is like kind of wealthy Druid.
Yeah.
That was a cross-language joke, I guess. It didn't go through well.
I'm gonna laugh later.
I'll still need to work on the Polish. So he's gonna see where the bombs go, which is gonna obviously impact the rest of his turn in terms of where he attacks with the weapon, whether he slams anything. I imagine the Dread Corsair is gonna come down no matter what, though.
Oh, this is beautiful. Well played.
Yeah, it does work pretty well.
Well played.
You can even slam the for free and just set it up for.
I like how he
he controlled those boom bombs. Yeah, skillful.
That was very good. Now you should hit the Keeper as well for 3 damage or for 2 damage. Then you will win clear. Oh, that's better. Then you hit the Keeper for 4.
Yeah, there is like a 1 health minion.
Oh, well that was a misplay.
Oh, there's a Toad!
This is actually kind of scary though as well, because we can see there's still no combo pieces. There's like multiple large threats on the board now in terms of the Frothing Berserker and the Dr. Boom. So that's suddenly a lot of damage, and there's Grom Whirlwind in hand.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So the Warrior can come back from here.
I mean, yeah, it's just lethal next turn, right? If like the two big guys stay up.
Yeah.
Because the Whirlwind will give so much more additional damage to the Berserker.
You can, in theory, go through this Pirate and kill the Frothing. If you would go Druid of the Claw, Savage Roar, Hero Power, and kill the 3-3, and then charge your Druid into the 9-4. But with this, can you still do it?
I'm slowly getting worried that this Warrior is going to pretty much OTK next turn.
If there is Druid of the Claw as a taunt, would that be enough?
Top decks execute.
And that is like such an unfortunate game for Scruffy.
Actually, even a slam would be enough, because then you just fire War Axe attack into Druid of the Claw.
Oh no, because you can't proc the Grom, right?
Oh no, you can't proc the Grom, but then like you're giving a lot of attack to.
Yeah. No, we want the one turn kill. We want the full 27 damage.
Cannot Frothing just do it with so many minions on board? Look at this, Taskmaster. Yeah, I think.
So
that
Whirlwind 3. It should be okay. So this
plus 7 damage, so it's 16, 26 at least from just Frothing. And,
it's over 9,000!
It's a lot of damage, guys.
And now they're sat there going, I thought Frothing Berserker couldn't do this anymore.
Apparently it can! Apparently, can. So Janet Druid taking first game versus Druid with Patron.
So not the most standard Patron versus Druid game I've ever seen, but definitely a fun one.
Well, he did miss the combo. He had answers to Patrons. He was able to deal with the first Patron wave. He actually dealt with the second Patron wave. But overall, this matchup has changed a bit since the times of Warsong nerf, because right now you do have a lot of midrange minions. That's why Gaara says also, like, statistically,
it's favored like 56%, 57%. That was even at the time where Patron was OP. But man, Scruffy must be feeling like pretty disappointed, because as we saw, he had also Harrison Jones teched. So he was probably pretty happy to get that matchup. And the patron was down to like 11 health at some point and not be able to finish him, even with like a keeper on board. Like, as you said, like he would have killed him if just Savage Roar.
Yeah.
And he had like so many draws, and this was kind of unfortunate.
There's also one more thing. He had this Harrison Jones deck specifically for Doomhammer and Shaman, and right now his druid is dead. He's not able to use the druid anymore.
That's so true, yeah.
Do you think he's teched Harrison to any of the other decks? Yeah, that would be interesting, because we saw from the previous set where Harrison was just used just in general because of it lined up against, like, you're expecting multiple weapon classes.
I did talk to him before the match, and he said he's bringing Control Warrior. So I believe that in Control Warrior you will also run Harrison specifically.
Also, like, if he's bringing Reno Lock, a lot of people are playing Ooze in Reno Lock, so that would also make sense.
Is this a full lineup trying to beat Shaman?
Look at that Toad. It croaked, and it deals one damage.
That's so perfect on the Armorsmith.
Dealed one damage, healed one life to the warrior.
Yes, that one didn't work fully, but the frothing finish.
Look at this. Oh my god.
It's so beautiful.
Gives me nightmares about a few months back.
Look at those plays, man. Look at those plays. Craigism.
I'm super happy that in Hearthstone, Grommash is actually a thing. Like in WoW TCG, Grommash wasn't playable as a card. Like nobody was using him overall. And I really like Grommash from Warcraft lore. He was one of the most scary orcs in the very beginning, just from the Warsong clan. They were shouting, and the shout was so terrifying that the humans were just running away. And here, Grommash is the representation of that. Like, he might not be shouting, but when he charges, people
are... He definitely
are
makes an impact when he hits the board.
That's for sure. And he is terrifying in a way, right?
You're such a great storyteller, Nimsh. It's like you could make a show, like, just listen to you tell us Warcraft
stories.
Story
time with Nimsh.
Yeah.
I just had to improvise on the fly because you were Silent Guard.
that was great. That was interesting. Fun facts about Grommash.
Okay, so we are going to see the Warrior Mirrors, but it doesn't look like the decks are the same. So as you said, it is going to be Control Warrior versus the Patron Warrior. And this Patron actually is running the Korkron Elites. What do you think about... So we've discussed this a couple of times over the weekend of, you know, Korkron, Shredders, and, you know, even the... I think Monkeys came up as well.
There was Monkey in one of the decks. But Gara, what do you think about Korkron?
In the Tempestom.com list, it doesn't run any Korkron Elites.
So it's bad. Yeah. Is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah, it must be wrong, right? So, like, one guy qualified top 8 and he used the list from Tempestom.com. That was kind of funny. And it had Shredders and Belchers. And I talked to a lot of people about what is, like, the strongest patron list right now. And the list had, like, a lot of taunts, a lot of Belchers, a lot of pirates. Some lists around two pirates. And the Korkron Elite seems to be, like, a little bit old. Like, I remember, like, a couple months ago, right after the Patron nerf, people played like a lot of Korkron Elite, but it fell out of the favor a little bit, so I don't understand why.
Well, Korkron does, you know, provide you more flexibility with regards to charging, and it does respond to Zoo in a way that you can kill minions easier. Like, let's say there's a Dark Peddler, you charge into it, it dies, and you still have 4/1 on board that can attack into something else. So it is an okay minion. If it's better than Shredder, or like is he running Shredders at all?
Probably not. That's
If you run Korkron, I imagine you don't really run the Shredders. The Korkron's just more of a pressure card, right?
Exactly. So he can be more aggressive with his plays as well because he knows he has Korkrons in the deck. Like, after using Grommash, he can always Korkron in rage for 6.
Yeah, but overall, I'm guessing we pretty much agree that this matchup is rough for the Patron. Although, I think every time at least I've cast it this weekend, it's actually been really close games.
Yeah.
So we saw the Powder Tice game early today, and then I think we saw one of the Crane games, where he was playing Patron versus Control Warrior, and that was really close as well.
Yeah, oftentimes you play the Patron, you're like, oh man, I'm unfavored. Then you play the Patrons on 5, and the opponent has no brawl, and then suddenly you win.
You're like, oh, nice. Hang on a minute.
Nice.
Well, this time, actually, Scruffy has almost everything. Like, he has Bash for the early game, if there's something like a Korkron Elite or Shredder.
And he kept the brawl in the Mulligan.
Yeah,
I just
absolutely
wanted to point that out.
That was a good decision. Like, this is a card you need on 5 if the Patrons go in. And as this matchup is so bad for Patron, that sometimes you just have to go with the Patrons.
Yeah, especially if you run only one Brawl. A lot of people run 2 Brawl now just for this.
But yeah, I agree. I think, and we've said this before, where you do just do the Patron turn if you can. Yeah. Because if they don't have it, you can win. And if they do have it, well, you're kind of expecting it anyway, right? It's still a good turn because it eats their whole turn 5 on a Brawl.
The fun fact for Janne is that he actually, even though it's an unfavored matchup, even though he might be in a very bad position and he knows he's losing, it's still good for him to continue playing to see as many cards from this Control Warrior as possible. Because he knows, like, if he loses this, he will face this warrior again. So we really want to know if there is double brawl. Is there anything else in Grommash? How many bashes that are being played? Stuff like that.
Yeah. But even if he loses this, I think he's in a great spot. Like, he has Midrange Druid and Aggro Shaman. And that's, like, two great decks for Control Warrior.
Yeah, how is Aggro Shaman versus Control Warrior?
It's too fast. It does too much damage. Like, the Doomhammer is just insane. Like, you need those cards. Yeah, that's the variants of Shaman. You can just draw a bat. You can have, like, double Lava Burst starting hands. Then it sucks. And you don't draw your Doomhammer. But if your opponent doesn't have Harrison Jones, it's just too much pressure. Like, your insane heal cards are just too slow. Like, you have Justica in those cards, but Shaman kills on turn 6 and turn 7.
Yeah. I wonder if Jan is playing the Chucky version with only one Doomhammer. Because we have two different different Shaman lists. Yeah. One was having Dr. Boom, and the other was with Elemental Destruction.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he played also, like, Flame Tongue Totem.
Yeah, so I think Jan is playing the one with the Flame Tongue Totem, the Chucky list.
Interesting.
Yeah, I mean, like I think I said yesterday, when Chucky was asked about the list, he actually said that the Flameton Totem was the highest win rate card in the whole deck, so that's pretty cool. But back to this game, this is looking progressively more rough for the Patron Warrior, I think. He does have the sort of four Patron turn of Whirlwind, but when we can see there's Bash, obviously the Brawl, even Executes, the Fiery War Axe, there's all the answers he could ever want to deal with this Patron board, and Lothep's going to be okay to follow up with, but there's nothing else that's really going to put a lot of pressure on from the Patron side.
Well, there is a chance that the Patron will actually survive the Brawl, right? So if the 3-3 Patron survives... Oh no, there is a Shield Slam now. So
yeah, he doesn't have to Brawl.
Alright. Well, now he can, but... So what's the best version?
Yeah, I think actually, Fire War Axe Bash 3-4-5... Fire War Axe Bash and Shield Slam. Or Execute, whatever.
But it's also like a lot of cards invested into that.
Yeah, but then like you will have Brawl for another Patron wave if it shows up.
Yeah.
So you know you're set.
And also what's kind of cool is like this might be duking the fact that he might be telling his opponent he doesn't have Brawl. Because Brawl seems like there's so much like the natural reaction to a Patron turn. So his opponent might actually think, oh, okay, he's not got Brawl. I'm just going to start throwing everything else down on the board. And then
yeah, that's a good point.
And then play into it a bit more.
But I think in this specific board, Brawl wouldn't be so bad. There's a chance his minion survives, and if that happens, it's insane. And if any patron survives, he had like the Shield Slam and the Execute to kill it. Because he kind of had to invest quite some cards here.
He can Brawl now.
Yeah, that's great.
But he doesn't have to. He still has a Shield Slam that just kills Dr. Boom.
Yep. I like Shield Slam here. Because he can Shield Maiden as well. Not that he needs the armor, but I mean, like, he fills out his curve, puts a 5-5 on the board. So what, like, Shield Slam, Trade.
And then play Shield Maiden. Yeah.
Leave a 5-5 on the board feels pretty good.
I think that's the play.
Like, some people make the mistake to hold on to, like, counter cards for too long. We've seen also it yesterday. I think it was Powder, like, not using the BGH for the Dr. Boom. He saved it and used, like, Power Whelming, Shadow Flame and stuff. And then he ended up dying to Fatigue and with BGH in his hand. Like, he lost the game with the BGH.
We've actually seen Gaara not playing a tempo BGH, even though he was playing two.
Yeah, because I didn't have the second BGH in hand.
Yeah, at the time.
Because I would lose to a Dr. Boom. But when I had the second BGH, then I actually
played it.
I remember it as well, James.
Nice!
Oh, wow, that one damage. I mean, he can use Execute if he wants to, but that one damage from the Boom Bot kind of sucks. Just because he has Fiery War Axe ready.
Yeah, that hand blows.
Is Lothair but Ghoul ever a thing? No, because he's got the weapon equipped.
Yeah, but even if he knows he's lost, he should continue playing anyway. This is no Conquest, so, you know, last year's ending, it's actually valuable to play. What do you like, Gaara? Do you like more dragging the game and seeing the cards in last year's ending, or do you prefer Conquest where you just don't care? And
I prefer everything that is not Conquest. I'm like probably like the biggest Conquest hater.
How did you enjoy the Swiss part overall?
It was fun. Like, I like it. Also, like, man, when they have like a DreamHack Sweden, when everyone brings like iPads and mobile phones and his own stuff, and there's like so many disconnects, and here we have like this nice setup, so it was really enjoyable to play.
Yeah, because the stable, a connection, everything.
Also good computers.
Food and drinks. like, yeah.
Yeah, fruit and rings and cold air.
Yeah, actually,
massages.
The rooms are pretty good overall.
Yeah.
I didn't try the massages yet.
No?
No. Raven, have you tried the massages?
I didn't even know they were. Is Garrett trolling or is there actually?
Dude, they're everywhere.
Okay, so this is looking really rough for the Patron Warrior here. I mean, to be fair, the control warrior doesn't really have tons in hand, but he doesn't need anything, right? He just needs to not die. And after clearing off one set of patrons already, this is going to be pretty much an uphill climb as to whether Patron can even remotely get close to killing the opponent.
Well, to be honest, if you look at the board, Patron just got the board presence where Warrior doesn't have it.
The big scary 2-2 when the Warrior's on 47 health.
Actually,
they can shield slam it. It's fine.
Actually, I think it was a mistake to use the Taskmaster there. Because you need the Taskmaster for a Patron draw, for an Acolyte draw, to utilize, as you can see. That because he had a Battle Rage as well. Like, you have to enable your Battle Rage and another Battle Rage. And to enable the Patron Warrior or Acolyte. I think that was like, he played it too fast. It was,
yeah.
I think it was really not so good to
And
use.
The thing is as well, like, he killed off an Armorsmith.
Yeah,
His opponent's got a million armor anyway, so like, the armor may as well almost be like whatever number you want at this point in the game before you can build a board and actually start knocking it down.
That might actually be a game-losing misplay there. Even though it was like a small thing, it's really important to point out. As you can see, he drew like another Battle Rage and he drew the Patron. He would have had like a so much better hand now.
Yeah, definitely. It seems like he just gave up at that moment and just wanted to play cards by default. So he didn't really think about that decision. This is a really good catch here.
Because Armorsmith is just one damage pressure per turn. It's really not so important to... Like, you see that people who play Justicar, like, if someone has 5 power on board, they just hold on to their cards, like, till he overextends into Brawl or
definitely,
something. Because it's just 1 point of damage pressure per turn.
Same with Freeze Mage, like, you just, if there is, like, 5 to 6 power on board, and if you are still at around 20 plus, you just ignore this and keep your removal cards. I was talking to Janet Druid a couple of times yesterday, and he said he's super nervous while playing, so... It's really easy for him to go into the default mode, I believe.
Oh, we had that as well, like in the beginning, like Moody when he was playing. I think you two were just casting and he had double Innovate, Dr. Boom, I don't know if you remember, against Renolock. And then he ended up roping and not playing anything. And this is like when you play on stage for the first time, you know, you're on stream.
Yeah.
But I know like he's such a good player, he would never do that like off stream. And
definitely, yeah.
It really changes.
It's definitely tense and like it's a high pressure scenario as well. We discussed it a little bit before and yeah, it can definitely affect the lesser experienced players. Obviously, you would never make a mistake like that.
Oh,
with all your years of experience.
I get nervous like very often. Taste my
blade. Look at this Taskmaster, it's still on board, it's still doing pressure. Back to work. Is there an execute off top? Nope.
Man, I really wonder how this game would have went if he would have had more patrons, more cards.
No, Whirlwind! So the Taskmaster can survive! Yes!
All in on the 2-1, go. Oh my god. I think he's got a lot to do here if he wants to chip down all of this health. Considering just the hero.
Oh my god, just to rub it in, the Harrison.
Do you want to show the Harrison though? Like,
For BM purposes, of course.
Yeah, and I think in Control Warrior, you're expecting Harrison, right? It's not like a shock that people don't play Harrison this deck.
Yeah, you do, but actually showing it has some value as well.
Yeah, it's better.
It's because Face Shaman might be afraid to play the Doomhammer now.
Yeah.
Like, Face Shaman, when you play Face Shaman into Control Warrior, you will want to play Doomhammer as early as possible and deal that damage. But if you know the Harrison is the deck, you'll be like, oh man, I play it, I just lose it. So I better keep my Doomhammer with in my hand. Till I get the Rockbiter.
Yeah. I played my second Sea Giant against Freaky, so he sees it, so he doesn't kill Zoo against me. Because it's like so good to have 2 Sea Giants, and he still kills Zoo anyways. It's bad, man.
So that one didn't work.
It's bad, man.
Didn't win the mind games on that one.
Yeah.
There's so much psychology happening in Hearthstone all the time. Like, playing the card you just top decked, or like waiting to make your opponents a bit more
irritated. Top deck, man.
No. I just had a side thing, so I'm just like, yeah.
Yeah, at this point, Janet Druid just wants to see more cards. That's it. Like, okay, show me Harrison. What else do you got?
He should just never play a card now and just attack with Harrison. Harrison every turn. And the death spike.
I think the only threat he has left in his deck is Dr. Boom. The opponent has Execute, Sylvanas, and BGH.
He has options.
Yeah, but it would be nice to see. Is Sylvanas standard? I guess it is.
Yeah,
I'd say so, yeah.
But the Revenge is not standard. So if he sees Revenge, that's some knowledge.
Yeah, Revenge is becoming really common, though, in Control Warrior, like, lately. It just becomes such a standard pick, because, like, I think Lothar was saying earlier, actually, where, like, the main reason is because, like, the one mana normally doesn't really make too much of an impact on the Control Warrior's turn.
Yeah.
Whereas the extra two damage, potentially later on, can actually be huge and just clear a board.
And I think that a lot of people got that from Fibonacci. Fibonacci runs double revenge, and he's like so famous, and everyone is talking about him. And they're like, oh, he's running double revenge. Maybe
must be a good card.
Yeah, must be good.
He runs Deathwing, and people are always cutting Deathwing out of his list and just playing something else instead.
Like, so many people, like, on EU play Tournament Medic after, like, Fibonacci reached rank one out of nowhere. It's just...
There's actually, on Temple Storm, there was a discussion that there was the Fibonacci deck with Deathwing, and then the comments were all about, like, Deathwing is, like, it's a bad list, like, this guy who created this probably doesn't play much Warrior.
It's like, such an idiot.
It's Fibonacci.
Tournament Medic, you guys are trolling me. Who's responsible for this?
Yeah.
The thing is, as well, I think there's something to be said where certain players can make certain cards work and know how to play them a lot more than other players, like the general player. Because cards like Tournament Medic and even like Deathwing, you can actually mess up a Deathwing play, right? There's a certain time in which you play that card for it to be very effective.
Exactly. It reminds me of an old Yagut. The new Yagut is not doing this stuff, but the old Yagut could just take...
just any cards in the deck and be like, yeah, I'll just get rank one legend.
Exactly, sure. Exactly. The new Yagut is just net decking.
Yeah, but this time, the old Yagut would be rank one legend.
Yeah. I still have bad memories of playing against Yagut in a tournament. He reverse sweeped me with mid-range Shaman. I felt very bad.
Oh, man.
And it wasn't too long ago either. That's the problem. It wasn't like back in the day.
Yeah.
Just killed me with Bloodlust every single game.
Good old Yagut.
Yeah, we need to bring him back. Somebody has to call him right now. But Jenna Druid lost the game, which was a really hard matchup, and that was the Control Warrior that was supposed to counter the Patron. It's quite even now, 1-1, and the Warrior winning both of the games.
Yeah, and actually for him, seeing the Harrison might actually affect his decision, because both of his decks are good against Control Warrior. Like, he has Midrange Druid and Shaman, but seeing a Harrison, so you might think it's probably better to go with Druid, you know?
Absolutely. Especially if you're called Jenna Druid.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind Druid too much here, because, like, the Shaman's still good versus, like, the Warlock, potentially. You know, if he has to fall back on that. And the Druid's good versus Warlock, so if he gets the kill on the Warrior. I suppose it depends which type of Warlock it is, actually. If it's Zoo, then it could be a problem.
But what's amusing is that we used to say that this kind of Druid is heavily favored versus Control Warrior, but this new Control Warrior breed with Bash, with Justice or True Heart, can actually stop a lot of cards Druid can apply, like Pilot Shredder being Bash being their great response, and then with True Heart, you can actually escape the range. Like, I've seen many games where Druid was just sitting on double combo, 22 damage, and Warrior
can't kill him.
40 health.
Yeah, it's like every Control Warrior deck is like a fatigue deck automatically. Yeah. Now it's crazy, you just fatigue the Druid. Also, like, people who play Aspirants and Living Roots, you cut so many like threats. Almost nobody runs Sylvanas or like Ancient of War additionally, so you have
remember Scenarios
back in the days.
Who
Scenarios? Who?
Ragnaros.
Yeah, that was like the worst case scenarios for the Warrior every time Scenarios came down.
Yeah, that's why the matchup was so good as well. In a sense, because, like, mostly it's just you want to have board control as Druid, and then you want to slam the combo and deal more than 14 damage, just buffing your minions on board as well.
But this hand sucks. Luckily, the Druid hand sucks as well.
Not well, he can still top the Wildgrove.
It's really interesting to me seeing how many of the players this weekend have tried to do, like, the mind games of hovering over a card every turn. To see, you know, like, pretend they have something to play.
This takes me back to a game, Lothar versus Gaara, at one DreamHack, where Lothar had nothing. He only, like, his lowest card was Shield Maiden, but he mind game Gaara every turn, and Gaara, instead of playing cards, he just taught him up every turn. Remember the game?
Yeah.
do you remember that game, Gaara?
I actually do remember that game.
Because you were, like, playing around the removal cards he can have, and then he didn't have them, but he did actually, like, drag the cards every turn, roped every turn.
I mean, you cannot do that. Like, you would play against turn 9 combo against Druid every single time if you can. Yeah. Like you don't care if he has it or not.
Yeah.
But anyways, he drew, like, Innovate and Wildgrove, so that's pretty good.
Yeah, that innervated wargroove changes the hand a lot. Do you slam the wargroove this turn though, and just pass?
I mean, he passed last turn to save the coin, to play like Drake into Drake, and now he got the wargroove, so he's like, damn it.
And the problem as well is, like, I think Drake's pretty good, but you're Draking into like turn four.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's the only worry. You spend it in innervate to put a 4-4 into a death spike potentially. We can say it doesn't have it, of course, and the cycle's always nice, so he's going to get rewarded for this play to a certain extent.
And that is probably the only time I'm happy to see an innervate when I see a Drake. Like, out of all minions, like, Shredder sucks, Emperor sucks, Boom, Lore. But Drake, you're like, oh, I can kill that.
Yeah, like, even if you just play Sludge Belcher on turn 5, Drake doesn't kill it, and your opponent doesn't get anything out of Drake. And Druid doesn't even benefit that much from the spell damage of the Drake.
But now he must be happy, man. Not seeing a Death Bite, Drake surviving, that's great.
It's like, so oh my god, it's still alive, what?
Do you actually still favor the Shredder here instead of Coin Drake? Or because of the Death Bite, do you think you can get away with Coin Drake?
It's more sticky, that's the same damage. You can save the coin for like a 7 minion that you might draw. You will probably save the Wildgrove now for cycling at some point in like 5 turns.
There's even potential that he could like coin out Emperor next turn if he draws into it and stuff like that.
So exactly, exactly. It's better to keep the coin. Like, even for the combo on turn 8, if you get it.
Well, I definitely think like the Coin Drake isn't a bad play at all. It does just cycle more. He's got he's got one of the combo pieces. He might just want to really cycle, and he might feel that these two are like really safe because you know he's not seen that Death Spite. But the Shredder's definitely the stable play.
He's even though he has like a full hand, he's missing really a lot of crucial things. Like, he has no 7 drop, he doesn't have the full combo, he doesn't have swipe. He still needs like a lot of cards.
Good positioning though. Yeah. He positions it so that Force of Nature can actually get bathed by Phantom Totem. Alright, Belcher it is. Not much, but it's something. And Warrior's still at 34. What do we do now? So Wrath.
You could Wrath Coin Keeper. And then just, you know, continue to push damage. Because as you said earlier, one of the issues the Druid can have is if the Warrior just gets too much health and then you can't burst him down. So that could keep up the pressure. You have Druid of the Claw to follow up. So I wouldn't mind that too much. You still push for 4 and kill off the whole Belcher. And you still have another Keeper of the Grove, right?
Is it worth silencing? Yeah. No, it's probably better to just kill it and attack with the Shredder into the 1-2. I like it.
Yeah, you have the second Keeper of the Grove, and to be honest, like, in Control Warrior, there's not actually too many silence targets anyway. So I like the Belchers are probably the priority for, you know, using the Keeper of the Grove one way or the other.
Yeah, exactly. Well, and you don't really care about Acolyte of Pain that much anymore. Warrior has
not at this point, no.
But he I would really want to draw with this hand. Like, he really needs a lot of things. He needs to find lore, he needs to find the full combo. So I can see that, and then now silencing it, attacking it with the Zerudrake and going face with the Shredder.
Yeah, because it's like one damage is hard to deal with as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine as well. Absolutely. And it's not about like positioning being bad right now, because he still thinks about the Force of Nature passively, right?
I actually wanted to ask you, what about the positioning now?
Yeah, I'm still thinking about Force of
Nature. Because Twitch chat wants to know, right?
Yeah, the positioning is still good because Drake is supposed to die, and then you will have the minion on the left side of the Shredder, I guess. It's like swapped. Is it left or right, Gaara?
It's left.
Raven, are you on the right side or left side?
I'm on the correct side.
Okay.
On the correct side.
It's left, yeah.
So
still, this feels really slow for the Warrior.
But this will be...
When you have Trueheart, Belcher, you know, even the Harrison potentially is tempo in hand, and then you have to just, like, 2 mana Whirlwind with an Acolyte like and execute, like, oof.
The Warrior will always be behind on board. I really don't see the Warrior winning this.
Yeah, because, like, this is exactly what Druid wants, right? Like, you have board and you have the combo in hand already. You have Dr. Boom as
charge.
Well.
Charge!
So you're just pressuring.
Yeah, I actually really like charge here. Yeah, this is nice.
Yeah, just deal as much damage as possible to get them to come range.
Good choice.
And you've seen an execute as well, so, like, who cares? There's nothing on the board that you need to taunt. And then you just follow it with Boom into their
never
combo, potentially.
Never Death Spite Baby Rage.
Yeah, that sucks.
So what can you do now? There is Bash to deal with something.
Concede.
Come on, Gaara. Have some faith.
Let's believe.
Something you could do is actually play Belcher and Armorsmith, because you're only guaranteed at least, you know, like, what, 3 armor? Even if he clears the Armorsmith with a 4 attack. So, you know, that's something at least. And then maybe build into, like, if he draws, like, a shield slam to do shield maiden, shield slam next turn to try and get on top of this board. But with the Dr. Boom follow-up, even with the BGH, the Boom bots are actually still a problem because the Force of Nature combo.
Do you play Dr. Boom here, though?
I would never play Dr. Boom. It overextends too much into
board. Yeah, and you don't really respond to this board.
Like, you expect the warrior to have, like, a bunch of reactionary cards, like Brawl. Like, the way how they played the warrior, he didn't have a single weapon. Like, he didn't play, like, Shield Maiden, Shield Slam this turn. Like, what is this in his hand? You wouldn't expect, like, every single late game.
Double Brawl, for sure. Like, Grommash, you would expect that. Justicar True Heart, maybe, because there still wasn't a window to play her.
Is there any reason to actually just silence the Belcher? Maybe kill off the Armorsmith, but then go face? Because then you're going to... and then you can play Wild Growth to go into a combo next turn, potentially?
Yeah. I don't hate that. I think that's actually fine. You cat into the 1/4.
Yeah, I think this is okay.
Yeah.
It sets up for the combo next turn and pretty much says to the warrior, like, you know, I'm purposely playing, like, sort of a suboptimal play in terms of mana curve to then go into turn 9, which, as you said earlier, Gary, you know, you have to play around
and
combo.
And this is a bot which is, like, also brawlable.
You should play Murloc Paladin, Gary. yeah, I do agree.
And, like, after the brawl, he would just slam Dr. Boom in like in 0.1 seconds.
This is so scary overall. Like, so many minions on the druid side. You can deal with them right now, but you cannot leave minions overall.
Kind of awkward as well, because although we can, like, deal with them to a certain extent, the is he not gonna execute?
Oh yeah, I was, like, saying, why did you do that?
How much is the combo then?
Because he can't play the shield maiden either.
22.
So.
Yeah.
Like, if he attacks into the 2/3, the combo is 22 damage, so he's not dead yet.
He did the maths.
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, do you combo this?
Do you...
just in case. Like, I mean, 22 damage to face is good.
I was thinking of, like, do you potentially just Force of Nature and Hero Power to clear the board and keep pushing with the Keepers? I just don't know whether that's actually leaving enough power on the board to continue.
Do you ever consider Alexstrasza as well?
Like, Dr. Boom Hero Power doesn't look so bad. You kill the Belcher and go face with 2 damage. Like, if he doesn't clear the board, he's dead next turn.
Yeah.
Usually you don't use combo. Only if you're absolutely forced to, then you use combo for clearing.
So, good point.
There could be an Alexstrasza, there could be, like, so many things. Like, Warrior has so much heal.
Are you losing too much tempo if there is a Big Game Hunter?
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, you could also lore, but man, Dr. Boom is so much more bot presence. But he has, as I mentioned, like, earlier, like, he hasn't played so many cards. Like, he didn't have the weapons and stuff. You expect cards like BGH. Like, that's the first thing that come in mind. Brawl, BGH.
Actually, what about the combo and clearing the minions?
Yeah.
Just Force. Like, not use full combo. Just
yeah, that's what I said earlier. Like, yeah. Force of Nature and Hero Power to clear off the minions and leave the two the minions on the board to push.
Alright, so as we can see, there are a couple of interesting options.
Yeah, also that he decided to use, like, to not protect the Keeper. He used, like, he just killed off the...
Yeah, killed it off instead of leaving both alive.
Yeah.
Which is interesting as well, when considering you have Force of Nature.
So there can be a Big Game Hunter, easily. But the bombs, like, the bombs are threatening by themselves, not only because they can explode, but if there is a Savage Roar, they do deal 3 damage.
Is he on 20 with combo this turn with the bombs? Not that he's probably going to use it, because now obviously he's definitely too far away with the warrior being on 27.
Oh yeah, Lothar.
Don't be so fast.
Yeah, you might actually force.
Just Savage Roar is also, like, so powerful.
Ooh.
Just Savage Roar is just so powerful.
Living Grits is nice. It can help him to clear.
I think depending on how these boombots land, he probably wanted to do, like, Drake into Lothar and just reduce down the options the warrior has, and then, you know, try and build on that the following turn.
I would say this was one of the situations where he was forced to use his combo pieces to remove. Now he will be behind on board. Then the combo just...
Yeah, because warrior is still at 24.
Yeah, I don't like that he just ran the...
And next turn, like, warrior can just deal, just heal 6 damage because of the Justicar.
Also because of the mana, you know? Like, instead of playing Lothar now, he has to use Living Roots to kill one of those. And the combo will... Like, he's way out of range now without the board. Like, the combo... It's like, now it will end up being, like, a dead card in the hand, sort of.
Yeah.
Because the warrior will not stop playing big minions now.
And the death spread as well.
Finally.
That's risky. But because there is no Big Game Hunter now.
Yeah, but he hasn't seen one. Now, like, this is a way where the Druid could turn the game again. Yeah. Like, if he finds a BGH, he's back in the game. Back in business.
That's just a shade. He can still draw two cards. And if he doesn't find a BGH, he will be in trouble. It's 15 damage. So if you think that Alexstrasza is a possibility...
I still like to see this Force of Nature used, because he has two.
Yeah.
So, like, even Force of Nature Shade this turn, you don't care about the five attack from the Shield Maiden.
Yeah.
Kill off the Grom, and then you're setting up the Shade then for, you know, for the combo the following turn. Whereas this is just, like, super dangerous. He's going to put you to 10.
It's still not over, though.
If there would be an Alexstrasza, it would be lethal.
Yeah, that's true. But then, like, Alexstrasza is not that popular anymore in those kinds of Control Warriors.
Just saying.
But Warrior is just escaping the range now. This is perfect for Scruffy.
Yeah. And now those combo pieces are sitting in hand.
You have Thorison.
Yeah, you wanted the double Savage Roll though and not the double Force.
And now, like, he could double combo, but the way how he played it, he's behind on board. Now he would be dead next turn if he doesn't remove it. So he cannot go for the Emperor into what he's trying to.
But Force and Swipe is fine.
This is just really weird, though, because he could have done this last turn.
Yes.
And still had the Shade on the board. So and I don't know.
Twice as much life.
Yeah. Because it's swiftly getting to the point where, like, it's going to be a lot of turns before this Shade is impactful enough to reduce down all this armor again, because the Warrior is now over 30 health.
Yeah, but it's not terrible yet. If there is Dr. Boom, he can go for Ancient Lore, trying to draw that Big Game Hunter again, and this time he has a better chance to get it. If he does that, he steals the tempo, and Warrior is actually running out of cards slowly. So if Genedrid deals with Dr. Boom without problems, and sets up his own board, he might be in a good position. But now Dr. Boom is a problem.
Super safe as well for him. He knows the opponent doesn't have BGH.
Yet. And now, can you really risk just trying to draw? Because if you miss, is he just going to set up the board and try to double combo next turn? So he forces his opponent to trade.
Oh, in terms of drawing into a second Savage Roll? This is what's risky. Like, what does Emperor Reduction do other than hoping you draw into a second Savage Roll?
Well, this is also saying, like, hey, I might actually have it next turn. So if there is a second Savage Roll, you will expect double combo next turn, being Scruffy. So you might get scared, and you have to kill Thorison unless you have lethal. And normally, being with only Dr. Beaumont on board, you should not have lethal unless bombs.
Unless bombs.
So he just needs to hit face for 4 damage total with the bombs. So 4 damage to face with the bombs and he wins, right? 11, that's 11 with the weapon. Just reducing the number of minions makes sense so that the bombs have a bigger chance to hit face. That's A4, so that's it.
Wow.
That's basically it with the death spite and Dr. Boom. Scruffy is taking another game and extending his lead to 2-1.
So now it's all in on this Shaman for the Johnny Druid here, and this is going to be a little bit rough, I think.
Well, yeah. Gara said this matchup is good, right?
Like, yeah, I cannot believe like that the like in terms of draws that the mid-range Druid actually lost. I feel like he had the game in his hand. Like, as soon as he played the Azure Drake and the Boreal had no answer for it, like, he could have just had board control. He had the combo, like, till the very end. But as it turns out, he just lost board control at some point. And then had the Warrior. It's so hard for the Warrior against the Druid, if you have, like, no weapons, to get the Justicar out. Like, it's so expensive. And because he at some point he had board control, then he could play it. And 4 armor per turn at that point, as you said in the very beginning, like, then it just you're just out of range, man. You just heal up for 4 every turn, and you have,
exactly.
Like, other cards.
And there are even little things where he chose to trade the smaller Keeper of the Grove, which actually killed it off, as opposed to trading the more healthy one to leave 2 minions on the board, because the Warrior's going to struggle with, like, actually just a big AoE other than Brawl, and then, like, the health of the minions doesn't really matter versus a Brawl anyway, so.
And he didn't have any of those core cards. He didn't have the early game, he didn't have the weapons, he didn't have Brawl, and he still managed to win.
It seems like Genedrid was overvaluing.
Yeah, I think this
combo
was the play. I think Force of Nature should have come down now with Hero Power and leave the 2 minions on the board and then continue on through there.
And Grumash just killing. But, was a bold move to finish the game quickly.
Besides that, he's now in a really, really bad position now that he lost with the Druid. I feel like that's
still a winnable match, right?
If
Shaman takes the Warrior fast, turn 5 kill, and then turn 5 kill versus Warlock, he just wins in the next 10 turns.
That's pretty reasonable. Just 10 more turns and you win. That's fine. Do we have any information on what the Scruffy's Warlock actually is?
At the moment, I guess not. Yesterday he was playing Zoo. So
yeah, against me as well.
Okay,
yeah.
So it's likely to be Zoo, right?
It's definitely likely to be Zoo. And he did win with that deck specifically versus Crane. And he had that Leeroy finish with Power Overwhelming. Yeah. So a pretty exciting one.
How do you feel the Shaman versus Zoo matchup is, Gary?
I think Zoo is very strong against all those like aggro-ish meta decks like Secret Paladin. I think Zoo is very favorite. It's just very, very, very strong to get the board control. And with Argus, like to push through that, it's like also the pressure from Zoo is so high with the Doom Guards and Power Overwhelmings. And if you get like a proc Nirup, just the counter pressure, you don't have the time till turn 6.
Yeah,
except you go first. I think going first is very important, like almost in every matchup.
Yeah,
for Shaman.
Exactly. If Shaman starts first, then he might actually overvalue in the very beginning and deal enough damage to finish the game.
You run so many one drops, right? So. And like speaking of one drops, that looked like a Trog into
just
one.
Just look at the like infamous combo of Trog into Golem. If you go second, it's so much worse.
But if there is a Fire War Axe, there is none. So Fire War Axe is one of those cards that's really needed versus aggro decks in the very beginning. If you miss it, you might get... Oh man, so the decision to get...
Going first, having Trog into Golem, that beats like most decks.
Yeah, and the thing as well is like, suddenly Fire War Axe just doesn't matter anymore because you can kill the Trog, but then the Golem's going to keep stacking up the damage and then he needs Deathbite or additional source of damage or an Execute and then it just starts to snowball from here, I think.
Well, he has Bash at least, so he was able to deal with the Trog before it gets buffed even more.
That's double bash, but the 4 health on the Golem is actually huge.
Yeah, that Golem was actually a huge draw overall.
It's crazy.
I mean, that's the strongest opener in Hearthstone right now. Yep. The turn 1 Trog into Golem going first.
What about double Leper Gnome? That like it's not good anymore?
Leper Gnome, coin Leper Gnome.
That's so sad. Just getting a second Wonder would be nice here.
Yeah, I think just Leper Gnome's still okay.
Absolutely.
Because the problem with Hero Power is it's not like you can play Leper Gnome next turn because you have the Argent Horse Rider to fill out the curve on 3. So I just like the Leper Gnome here.
Yeah, even if there's a Taskmaster, like... Well, actually, I guess it plays into Taskmaster in a way that Taskmaster would not be played. But if you totem up, Taskmaster can still be played on totem.
This is probably like the only matchup where you really like to have Taunt Totem. Taunt Totem is so sick against Warrior. Like, then he cannot even kill the Golem with the Deathbite.
Yeah.
Like, the Golem will deal like 12 damage or even more if he gets a Taunt Totem.
Which is just crazy. And this is where also having the minions early is the Shaman is key. You don't care about the spells that much early on because even if Deathbite comes down now, he has the Horse Rider next turn, as well as the Leper Gnome still alive. So you just continue to push damage that they can't keep up with.
So Scruffy decides to go for the draws now instead for the weapon. Like, Fireworks was super awkward there. Just stuck into Leper Gnome taking 4. Not really doing anything to the 3-4 as well. Was there any merit in just bashing the 2-1?
I think he really needs to dig and get the weapons and maybe a Belcher or something as well. And just try and slow the Shaman down.
I think...
Yeah, I would have actually traded the Golem here and totem up and then play the Flame Juggler. It's also like a lot of board presence. Charge is always good from hand. And you always can get the Taunt Totem. I really like to have the chance whenever I can to just try to roll for it. Because if he has Deathbite, he would attack it anyways. And so you basically just save the Rockbite. And Rockbite is so sick to save.
Yeah, it is. Exactly versus Warrior as well. If you get the Doomhammer at some point. But on the other hand, you want to have those minions. And the Argent Horse Rider, it is disgusting versus Deathbite. Like, if it's the only minion.
Yeah, I'm just saying because he used the Rockbite over the 1 health on the Totem Golem. And the Totem Golem, it was his turn 4, he would have just died to a Deathbite, so he just basically lost the card.
So Flame Juggler juggling 1 into the 1-4. Can we do it?
Easy. Every time, 50% of the time.
Are you not overextending into Brawl right now? If you play even more minions?
I think that the hyper-aggressive aggro decks can absolutely not play around Brawl. You go full ham. You just use Rockbite. It's like his 10 damage combo. Like, he doesn't have that anymore. Like, he doesn't have the Doomhammer now. He's basically all in. Like, those are the games with Shaman. You need those two tools. You need the Ancestral Knowledge to draw Burn, yeah, or the Doomhammer. But if you don't have both, you're really like in an all-in position.
Yeah, because it's like now he's really wanting to draw like Lava Burst or just, you know, something. Well, obviously mainly the Doomhammer, but, you know, like a Lava Burst, Crackle, just something to push some more damage, because I imagine we are going to see Brawl.
Actually, the Warrior is like in a really good position. He's double Brawl even. If he gets a good Brawl here, and the Shaman doesn't draw Doomhammer or Ancestral Knowledge, he has the Justica.
Oh, really? The Totem Golem's going to survive?
Oh, that is unfortunate.
Oh, my God. That was like the one. Maybe the Horse Rider as well would have been an issue, but this is rough.
That was nightmare.
Oh, yeah, man. He will drop to 14. He can't even kill it right now, so the weapon is useless. He still has the Shield Maiden to get some armor.
It's not too bad, yeah. Yeah, he has also Bash, and he's not in too bad position. He doesn't know the Shaman has nothing.
Yeah. Oh, come on, Flim Juggler is something. Lava Burst is okay as well. It's not that you cast it now, but... Oh, Taunt Totem.
Perfect.
Yeah, that's great for Janne.
The next turn, Spell Power Totem. Like a good player.
Like a good little
six
shame
to face.
Empire.
Weapon is not doing much right now, especially with that the Totem in the way. An Acolyte, I guess, to draw more cards. Or do you think about armoring up right now?
Or do you Brawl, let the Totem live, and then kill it? After that previous Brawl, probably not. I would be very afraid.
The Totem Golem will survive.
Yeah, again, it just has that hidden message of I will never die to Brawl.
Yeah,
he hopes that the... Oh, that's exactly... That's what he needed.
Yeah, but then like that... And there is John Totem.
Oh my God.
It works for him. It works really well.
Now it's over, basically. That's Doomhammer.
This Totem Golem has been on the board since turn two, guys.
Well...
It's crazy. Against a deck that specializes in removal.
It's really hard to kill it. It's a minion and it's a totem at the same time.
It's there's no card that kills a Totem Golem on turn two. What kills a Totem Golem?
On turn two?
Yeah.
Soulfire?
Soulfire? Who plays for Soulfire?
Seal of Light?
You have to use two... What?
No? Nah, I guess Seal of Light is plus two only. You need Shield Mini Ball as well.
Yeah, nothing kills at all. It's like the most disgusting card to remove.
There has to be something, Gara.
What? Tell me.
A 4-1 Stealth Pirate.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so
that's the thing.
Yep. Greetings, Traveler. And Janne is tying the series versus Contra Warrior. So that was really... I wanted to say impressive, but that was pretty fast.
Yeah, I think the Shaman just did what it's supposed to do in that matchup, right? Obviously, the Brawl not working out too well and leaving by far the worst minion for the Warrior to leave on the board. It definitely helped, but overall, like, that's the game plan for the Shaman, right? You know, they want to put the minions on the board early and then finish up with the spells. And obviously, the Doomhammer into Rockbiter, I mean, yeah.
It's a strategy, man.
It is a strategy, and it's like the whole deck revolves around that strategy. And Doomhammer is such a great legendary weapon.
Storytime with Nimsh. Everyone get comfortable.
Used by Orgrim.
Tell us more about Doomhammer.
It was used by Orgrim Doomhammer, and then it was used by Thrall during the second and the third war. So
second and the third.
Okay, actually, third war. Second war, Thrall was just a child, and he was imprisoned. But yeah, it's a good weapon.
Why was he imprisoned, Nimsh?
He was actually born a slave, more or less.
That's sad.
Yeah, that's why his name is Thrall, which is basically kind of like a slave.
Yeah. That's actually very sad.
Yeah, that's why he's making totems now, to have more friends, because he was so sad when he was imprisoned.
I'm pretty sure that's why he's making totems.
Probably. Also because he's a Shaman.
You're missing on those plays. Oh, damn, that top deck.
That's good. And now the matchup that we actually touched upon a bit. So Shaman versus Zoo. We do suppose this is the Zoo deck. We talked about it that Zoo can actually overpower Shaman pretty easily if it just stops the early game. Because early game is everything. If Shaman is able to deal a lot of damage with the small minions, then Zoo, well, it can't really heal. The only card to stop the Zoo is Lothab. So you do have to race. So it's either just build a Taunt Wall with Defender of Argus, kill everything you can with your small minions, or if you can't, just try to start racing and win with the Lothar block of the spells and then PO, Doomguard, whatever you have.
Yeah, we've seen some people earlier even taking Ooze in their Zoo decks. Maybe this is one of the matchups. If a Zoo oozes your Doomhammer, you will guarantee you lose that game.
That was Oneid in the last.
Yeah, set. I've seen it. I realized that Zoo is actually fitting, and like Ooze's fits Zoo deck because if you read Zoo, Ooze backwards or Zoo backwards, like Ooze or Zoo, whatever.
There's always a reason, isn't it? It's basically the same word, right?
Most educational caster you.
I'm trying. But to be honest, Scruffy knew that Genedrid is playing a Shaman, so I would not be surprised if he actually brought an Ooze.
So this looks like a Chucky list with a twist, because Chucky doesn't run Gormok.
So we spoke to Scruffy yesterday when he won his match, I think it was versus Crane, and he said he swapped Gormok because he doesn't think he's lucky enough to play Enhanced Summer Kano. So he doesn't feel he lands on the positive side of the Enhanced Summer Kano RNG. So he plays Gormok instead because he just feels it's more consistent and he can control the outcome a lot more.
That actually happened with me against Scruffy.
Guys, are you like, sorry Gareth to interrupt you, but I want to interrupt this program.
We need a moment.
To talk about double Trog opening into a Lightning Bolt.
He's probably like, because Golem. he's thinking to himself, he's like, is this really happening in a tournament?
Again?
To me? Am I the luckiest player today?
This is so perfect. And Scruffy was actually lucky to get a 2-1, but this 2-1 does not do much. I mean, it can kill one of the trucks. That's something.
Scruffy's like, please don't have a Totem Golem. Please don't have a Totem Golem.
I think we might have a new, like, Jenny Best Shaman.
Jenny Best Shaman, yeah.
Gara's title's going to be removed.
He looks very relaxed in real life now. He's like, he's pretty chill. Like, he's top 8. He's like, he's pretty, like, you know.
Well, he's almost top 4 now. After that, the Totem Golem.
After the Totem Golem. He's very close to top 4 now. You're like, I got this.
Okay, what do you even do? He got Doomhammer as well, which is
so
great
important.
Versus Zoo.
Yeah, you absolutely need it. Now he's gonna get... Oh! Another Totem Golem.
Seems like a good play.
He's like, sure, it's okay.
What about...
You killed my Trog, I know. I'll just play another Totem Golem, it'll be fine.
Yeah, I think it's actually fine. just to slam it and go face.
Is it?
I was thinking there's any way to like abusive a Trog, maybe kill the 2/4, kill an imp, but then like you're actually losing.
You
want
to overload now because you want to play the Doomhammer.
Exactly.
So that's like the main reason. Because if you play the abusive now and not Lightning Bolt, then you cannot play the Doomhammer 5, and that's usually.
And.
So he's overloading anyways.
Oh, he's actually keeping the Trog alive.
Yeah.
That's not bad as well.
Yeah, that's not bad.
I didn't see it. That's nice.
Yeah, it's okay.
Yeah, do you think the next turn the Golem's going to be worth more than getting the Doomhammer down on 5, or do you think he has to do something else next turn?
Like, if he would have had Implosion here, it was definitely a risk, because then he's kind of out of resources.
Oh, we missed the Juggler
man.
As well.
Oh,
yeah, the 2-1 is just killing the Juggler here. It's just not
working. Oh, now he's Juggler!
Well, yeah.
Oh, baby, I'm going to show you how to Juggler.
How to Juggler the Owl. 2? No, the Owl is dead. Okay, it's not.
I would have...
Traded first,
the 2-1, yeah.
Yeah.
Now it's awkward.
well, now do you just leave the Owl up and push?
If there is Defender of Argus...
Yeah, that's true. And he has Doomhammer next turn.
Exactly.
Anyway, right?
Exactly.
Against Zoo, it's like killing a minion is like basically doing phase damage most of the time.
I guess that's just Lotheb.
Oh, and then the juiciest Doomhammer
and
of his life.
How much damage to face? 9. Oh, and the Feral Spirit next turn as well to like block any threat. Like Lothab can just kill one of the creatures. We're like, sure.
Yeah, now I just think it's just too far behind. He's still one more turn from playing Boom. So, you know, like the sort of snap effect of playing Boom, then the next turn, you know, bringing the board back is going to be rough. The Sea Giant definitely doesn't help.
Yeah, a Life Tap doesn't feel good.
Life Tap turn 6 feels good, man.
Like Life Tap taking 2 damage if you're at 15.
I'm playing a Direwolf afterwards.
Well, but
hey, that Lothab can hit for 6, man. That's gonna be huge.
Is this the moment where you race? Raven, do you see racing possibilities here?
You just have to look at the player camps and you can tell who's ahead.
You have Shani just there, just swinging around in his chair like, playing Shaman, it's working.
As soon as he hit Trog, Totem Golem, he was like... Yeah. I'm going to show no mercy.
So, depending on how this turn plays out, I want to just watch Scruffy's face react to the Feral Spirit and just be like, okay, this is the way this match is
my life now.
Yeah, this is what's happening.
He's like, is this really happening? Yeah. Like, I'm freaking here and losing to this cancer deck.
Especially because...
Oh, he's already helping over well played.
Well played.
Like, yeah. Okay. Oh, my God.
Oh, man.
That's not lethal, right? So it's 4, 5, 6. No, it's
no, no, no.
You just play Feral Spirit.
Yeah. And you can kill the minions as well. Like, what is Zoo going to do? Like,
killing
ever?
Minions is doing phase damage. And here's the Flame Tongue. That was a good play.
Is he playing Twisting Nether in his Zoo deck? Reno Jackson.
Oh my God, the second Sea Giant.
Yeah, well played. How much damage? Come on, how much damage is there? I didn't even know. 10? It's actually enough, right? So
yep. Janna, and the abusive as well.
Yeah, definitely. Janna has enough. And Janna is advancing to the top four. To the top four. Today is going pretty fast, actually.
Yeah, and it's really interesting. We see like one of the few players who brought Shaymin is actually... Because didn't he 3-0 yesterday as well in one of the second to last game?
No. It was Chucky style. I think Janna had a tough match. Yeah.
But like we just see like the power of Shaymin overall at the moment, like, you know, multiple players performing really well with it so far.
I'm happy to have Gara best Shaymin to commentate that match with us.
Do you want to move up, Gara?
Yeah, just don't take it. Like, you're still with us, Gara. Don't go.
I'm still here.
You can still talk.
Yay.
All right, so Janna, welcome to the casting couch. How do you feel right now?
I feel bad. I lost Druid against Warriors.
Did you make any misplays?
It's okay.
I think I could play it a bit different and maybe then I would win.
I have good news for you though, if you feel bad. You doubled the money. Right now you won 2,500 at least. Does it make you happy at least?
Yes.
Okay.
I am happy. Shaman is pretty good deck for me right now, so it feels amazing winning with it.
So what was your favorite game? Like, okay, we know you're sad about Druid versus Warrior that you lost that one, but what was the game you were really proud of?
I think Shaman against Warrior.
Okay, and why is that?
I can't really say anything special about this series. Like against when I played Patron against Druid, I was really lucky, and then with Shaman, he had really bad draws as a Warrior, especially when he coined Bash. I knew he doesn't have any weapon.
Okay,
that's so mean to ask someone like about an. Face Shaman deck. Like, what was your thinking process, man? Face.
So how did you approach your lineup for today? Because we all know the players could change the decks from yesterday, but obviously it's a bit different. So you don't have to just prepare for one player. If you win, you prepared for the rest of the tournament. So did you really try and focus on beating Scruffy with your lineup, or have you just brought a lineup you think you can go all the way with?
I don't think I should say a lot about my decks right now, but. I didn't prepare just for Scruffy.
Okay. It,
I was I knew that he will like take Contra Warrior. I was really scared about it. But when I saw his lineup, I knew that he is not going to start with it and that he has Zoo and Shaman. I think it's really good against Zoo.
Okay, so Scruffy didn't surprise you that much. You expected the decks that he's bringing.
Yes. I played against him in Swiss stage and like against my both opponents in playoffs. I played in Swiss, so I knew what I can expect from them.
Okay, so that's some great knowledge you actually used to prepare for those specific opponents. Gar, do you have any questions?
No, it's pretty good thinking process. Like, he knew he would not open Warrior. He was very well prepared for it. As I also said, you had like 3 good decks actually against Controller. I think the whole lineup, even though you were behind in the series, you were still like in a pretty good spot to win it. And I think now that you beat Scruffy, like he kicked out Crane, he kicked out me, you're in a pretty good position to win it all, man. Congrats.
Yes.
All right. So congratulations again, Janna. You still have one more match at least, or maybe two if you get to the final. Maybe you'll become the champion today. So I'm sure the Polish community is really rooting for you. Everybody's sending you energy. Any words for the Polish community overall?
I want to thank all my teammates who helped me prepare for tournament, my team for making it possible for me to come here, and obviously for everyone who is cheering for me this tournament.
All right, perfect. We're looking forward to more of our matches today, but for now this match is done and we have to prepare the top four, which will take us a couple of moments. So stay with us for more Hearts and Actions just after the break.